like this. The fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. With every breath I'm singing, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Expecting child, they searched the inn to find a place for you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Star shone bright up in the east to Bethlehem. The wise men three came many miles and journeyed long for you. And to the place at which you were, the frankincense and gold and myrrh they gave to you and cried out, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know you came to rescue me. This baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath we drew was hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
microphone as soon as I turned around. And he's saying, go tell it on the mountain. He screamed every word. He knew the words. So maybe he was 4 or 5. Maybe he was 16. I don't know. 17, 18. I don't know. 22, something. Isn't it amazing, though, this time of the year, no matter where you are, you're going to hear songs that are talking about Jesus. I mean, you know what I'm talking about? And it's amazing to me. You go in restaurants, and maybe you went to a restaurant, and maybe you went to the grocery store, and you hear these songs of Christmas. And one of the things that grabs my attention all the time is this reality that time split in half because Jesus was born. Did you know that? Jesus' birth defines human history's timeline. How many of y'all remember being in school and you learned the timeline and you got to see the timeline? And there's a big section called BC, right? I thought it meant something fancy. I thought it was maybe Latin like the AD is, but it just means before Christ. And throughout human history, the Gregorian calendar was fully installed at 800 AD, that time was split in half at the birth of Jesus, and the whole world started recognizing that calendar. And so if you're going to celebrate 2021 hallelujah in a couple of weeks, are you sick of 2020? Anybody sick of 2020? Can I get an amen? I want it over. And I believe good things are coming in 2021. But if you celebrate that, you're celebrating based on a calendar system that is defined by the birth of Christ. All of human history, whether you're Muslim or Hindu or a Jew or a Buddhist, whatever faith focus you might come up with, you're still on this Christian calendar. And I don't know if we can fully get that. It's almost like hidden, isn't it? It's like, oh, is that real? Yeah. Jesus changed all of time. And around the world, whether people want to celebrate Christmas or not, whether Christmas means anything, the world knows it's Christmas time. I think of that song. Do y'all remember the song Feed the World? It was this big thing to get some supplies out. It was back in the 80s. You know, I'm an 80s kid. And I can still hear that. Feed the world. Right? Did you want to sing it? Let them know it's Christmas time. And I thought, let them know it's Christmas time. The whole world should know it's Christmas time, right? And why does the whole world need to know? Well, human history was split at Christmas. And I'm overwhelmed by that. And the passage, who read today? Did you read, Chip? It's been a long time ago. I can't remember back that far. But this passage that Paul is trying to explain to people who can't quite figure out what time is all about and their place in time, he says you need to understand that time really does matter. And if you thought about all the ways that time matters, I can tell you for 10 days in quarantine, time mattered. I was counting the hours and the days. I was sick of being at home. How many of you have been home for 10 straight days, round the clock, didn't go anywhere for 10 days? Anybody? I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You didn't go anywhere for 10 days. Isn't that horrific? No, you liked it, Carol? You enjoyed it? Oh, no. No. You liked it, Terry? You enjoyed it? Okay. Yeah, Kim was praying that I'd get better so I could leave the house. She was like, Lord, take him somewhere other than here. And time really matters. And there's so many times in our lives when time becomes more relevant to us. And you know, for some, I'm guessing Layla and Atlas are pretty excited about, like, Thursday. Is Thursday the day? Is it Thursday or Friday? It's Friday? Oh, it's both days because they're spoiled rotten, and they should be. And they should be. And it's such a big deal, this moment in time, right? And we wait. We anticipate. Like Pastor Chip's sermon last week. Simeon. Did y'all listen to his sermon? Anybody? Come on. I'm sorry, Chip. Shouldn't have done that. Shouldn't have done that. I never want you to tell me whether you listened to my sermon or not, because most of you didn't. It's okay, Alex. I'm not offended. I'm okay. But this idea of anticipating And you know, you thought about how long you waited till you turned 16. Come on now. Did anybody care about turning 16? Or maybe 18 or 21? Yeah. Wayne's driving. Yeah. I mean, for some of us, life began when we could leave the house in our car, right? You were no longer under the thumb. You could get away. There's so many moments in time, but time really matters, and human history moves around the time of Christ's birth. And so you heard the text, and I want to talk us through it. I'm going to fixate a little bit on verses 4 and 5. Let me just share those again. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. There was a right time. There was a moment in time when everything would change. Well, if you were secular today, you would might know the term before common era. They went away from before Christ because some people didn't want to say that. And so the secular world said, okay, now it's BCE, before the common era. And so BCE or before Christ or just BC, there was a time when we didn't know Christ. And do you think about before you met Jesus? Have you ever thought about what your life was like before Jesus? Do you ever get the creeps or the terrors, the night terrors, when you think of life before meeting Jesus? Did you ever have a moment in time when you really knew you were going to hell? Did anybody other than me ever know you were going to hell? Anybody? I knew I was going to hell. I mean, I'm not being flippant or talking like being silly. I knew I was going to hell. I knew I was dying and being separated from God, because I was living a sinful life, and somewhere I'd got enough information to know I was wrong. And I knew there was this time before Christ I still remembered. I remember being 21 years of age. I'd moved home to live with my parents because I wanted to marry Kim, and it was going to cost a lot of money. Can I get an amen? Hey, Drew, how you doing, bud? Just checking in. But anyway, hey, Micah. Hey, Jaden. Start saving you money. So anyway, I moved home, and I got under so much conviction. I was so afraid. I was 21 years old, sleeping in my parents' house with the light on at night. Do you think I'm crazy? Well, yeah, you know me. I was terrified, and I knew something had to change. Well, Paul starts to talk to the Jews, and actually the Jews and the Gentiles here, and he says, you knew there was a time before Christ came because they had met Christ. He had preached the gospel to them and they had received the promise of salvation that came through Jesus. But he says, you understand how things work. There's a time when you're underage. And you know, when you're underage, there's so many things you can't do, right? There's a bunch of rules, Colin, that you have to follow because you're in a certain age group and you can't just do what you want to do. Well, even as you move out of that age group, there's a lot of things you still can't do. But he says, when a father dies, if there's a child in the house, that child inherits everything from the family. The child receives all the inheritance, but they can't have it because they're a child. Now, I asked this in the early service, so forgive me. How many of you have been keeping up with Britney Spears? Thank you, Harmony. Harmony's in the early service. Come on. Nobody knows what's going on with Britney Spears. Come on. Thank you, John. Can I get, there's got to be one more person that knows. Anybody else know what's going on with Britney Spears? Sandy? I thought you were keeping up, Sandy. Okay, sorry. Okay, thank you, Jonah. Britney Spears is a tremendously wealthy woman. I don't know if you knew she's worth hundreds of millions of dollars, but she can't have her own money because her dad says she can't spend it well. And her dad is her legal guardian, and she can't have her money. And so every couple of years it comes up in the news, Britney Spears wants her money back. And her daddy says, you can't have your money back. And so Paul says, when you're a child, you can't have your inheritance. And you need to understand that before Christ, that's where we were. Even though we could have received all things, God wanted all things for us, we couldn't yet receive them because Christ had not yet come. And so he says, underage and without rights. That's where we are, underage and without rights before Christ. we were unable to do right. And that means we were clearly sinful, because what does the law do? History lesson, right? Old Testament hermeneutics and Old Testament 101. All the law does, all the Old Testament teaches, is we're all sinful. The law just, all the laws, on and on and on. The Ten Commandments remind us that we don't always obey them, right? You're all perfect, I forgot. You're all perfect other than me. And so the law, Paul says, was our school teacher. It was our guardian. And it says, hey, you can't, you're not old enough to do what's right. How many were told, you know, when you get older, you can do that? You're not old enough yet. Anybody remember those days? You wanted to do something, you're not old enough yet. And hallelujah, there's things I'm not old enough for yet. Of course, I am wanting that check. You know, you get every month. I want to be old enough for that. So, don't get excited. Okay, thanks, Ted. But then he talks about emancipation, and what he's talking about, they were orphaned by choice. You see, if your parents have died, you're an orphan, right? And Paul says to these children of Israel, you're like an orphan. It's like you could have all things, but you've chosen to be orphan because you've rebelled against your father. And you know, I was looking this up this week. You know, children, I think you have to be 16 years of age, can emancipate from your family. Did you know that? You have to go through court and be emancipated from your own family. You can do that if you don't feel like your family's taken care of. You can be emancipated. And yet that's what the Israelites did. They said, God, we don't want you. And you know what? Isn't that today's world we live in? God, we don't want you. Leave us alone. We want to be emancipated from God, which is separation from God, which is an eternity separated from God, which is hell and a lake of fire. I mean, that's what the Bible says. And yet the world screams to God, we don't want you. And so we're not going to say before Christ, we're going to say before the common era. Because we don't want anything to do with God. That's not an amen, is it? It's an oh me. Well, on the eternal timeline, before Christ was born, we were separated from God because we chose rebellion over family. We could have belonged, and yet we didn't want to belong. And you know what? There is something that's been gripping me for years. We live in a world, in a culture, in a worldview, a mindset of rebellion. Do not tell me what to do. I will not follow your rules. You cannot tell me what to do. Kim works with students all day long, and she clearly, I get to be home and listen to her teach for 10 days. I got to hear her teach, well, 7. And she would very calmly and kindly say, you have your workbook. You need to do section 4. Section 4 is very important. You need to do section 4. She didn't talk like that. And then she would say, they had a week to do section 4. And guess what? They didn't do section 4. Right? Is that you, Jaden? What are you doing, Jaden? What are you doing, Jaden? Like, oh, I ain't doing section 4. Harmony, did you do section 4? Okay, she did it. Being clearly explained as simply as possible, all you have to do is this. And yet we live in this spirit of rebellion. Don't tell me what I have to do. Well, and then there was the common era. Now, we had to listen to this on, you know, on your phone, you can type something in, and there's a little button you can push. It looks like a speaker, and you can hear how to say it. How many of you know how to say it's Latin, what AD stands for? Domini. You have to hold your fingers like this. I found that this helps. Anno Domini. Anno Domini. Am I close? Now that's Italian. It's not a Latin. It means the year of our Lord. And again, history was split in half, and Jesus was born. And Paul says, okay, you knew there was a time before Jesus, and now I'm going to tell you there's a time with Jesus. And in the fullness of time, at the perfect time, because God knows what time it is, at the exact right time. God says, now is the time. I'm sending you something. Because you can't get this right. You need my help. And the initiative continues. Did you know our God's an initiating God? Our God is always coming for us, always coming to help us, always coming to our rescue, coming to our aid. And I was going to preach on John 3:16, and this text kept blowing up in my mind. But for God so loved the world, right? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And then you got to throw in John 3:17, right? For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world might be saved. Listen, God is initiating, God is coming, and God is screaming, and God is proclaiming, and he's on the radio all day long right now, saying, oh, holy night, silent night, away in a manger, oh, come all ye faithful. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. God is screaming out, please, I'm here. I'm longing for you. So the initiative continues. God sent an oh holy night. The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. And this is the verse that grabs me, or the line. Long lay the world in sin and error pining. Just living in sin, overwhelmed by sin, saturated with sin. Till he appeared and the soul felt its worth, a thrill of hope. The weary world rejoices. Listen, are you weary? Are we in a weary world? Doesn't the world need something to rejoice about? For yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees. Oh, hear the angel voices. Oh, night divine. Oh, night when Christ was born. And Paul said God sent, at just the right time, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son, born under the law, born of woman, born under the law, that he might redeem us. To redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Emmanuel came. God is with us, and redemption. And so we receive. God sent, Jesus came, and we receive. Because God wants us in the family. Well, on the eternal timeline, Christ is born of Mary. The redemption of humanity has begun, and the price has been determined. Did you ever think about that? When Jesus was born, the price was determined as to what it would cost to redeem humanity. A baby. And the difference time makes. Well, there is purpose in the plan. And Paul, in this specific language he uses, I don't really know Greek. I took it for 2 years and I can look it up, but I don't really quite understand it all. But there is a thing called a hina clause. It's I-N-A, and it's whenever you're speaking, when you say, pay attention, this is the reason. And so over and over, Paul uses this hina clause to say, hey, now I'm trying to tell you something. I need you to pay attention right now. There's a purpose here, the whole purpose. I need you to get this, okay? Have you ever done that to somebody? Now listen, now if you don't hear anything else I say, isn't that the worst thing preachers ever say? If you don't hear anything, and you didn't hear anything I said, so anyway. There is a purpose in the plan, and it's about family. And family offers Abba Father. And he came to redeem us. And it says it this way, and because you are sons, and that's the whole purpose of all of this, you are the children of God. God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son, crying out, Abba Father. And that means daddy. Daddy, Father. And the whole purpose was that we were family again. And you ever thought about how important family is at Christmas and how horrific a death is at Christmas? Who do you miss at Christmas more than any other time? It's someone's not here, right? You feel that separation and you remember those days when you were all together, right? Those joyous times when you ate too much or you were around a tree and got gifts or the family all got together and you didn't get to see them all year long or at specific times. Bryson can't come home for Christmas. First time in 22 years I haven't been with my son or won't be with my son. Sorry, honey, on Christmas. That stinks. That stinks. But God said, I feel the same way. I really want us all together for Christmas. I want you all gathered together. And his spirit within us cries out, you are our dad. You're our dad. And we're family. We really are family. We are orphans no more. You see, sin makes us orphans. But Christ, his coming, made us family. And we are the children of God. We are orphans no more. And it's not just enough not to be an orphan anymore. And it's so interesting how Paul tags this on at the very end. Then an heir of God through Christ. That means, back to the very beginning, listen to this. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ from a slave, though he is a master of all, but is under guardianship. And so you don't get all the stuff. But now we get all the stuff. And you know, isn't that what we all think about at Christmas, getting all the stuff? Some of y'all done got some stuff, Micah. He got some stuff. And we think about the stuff. And yet what Paul says is it was so that we could all be family. That we could be brought back into the family of God to receive all the benefits of being in the family. And that was being an orphan no more. It was having all the goodness and possession of God. We are heirs to boot. Well, in the eternal timeline, God the Father had one plan for us all to be family again. And maybe this Christmas you'll think more about family than you've ever thought before because we've been separated and some will be separated. And you remember, family's important, isn't it? Don't you long for family? He is our Father. Christ is our brother, and the Spirit living in us cries out, we are family. Christmas is all about time. And you know, we sing, it's the most wonderful time of the year, right? Why? Well, all time change. God knows what time it is. He knows what we need, when we need it. He knows what's on the top of everyone's Christmas list. But it may be written in invisible ink, but it's there. We all need and want to be whole. We all need and want peace. We all need and want forgiveness. We all want and need love. And God sent it all, wrapped up in a little baby boy named Jesus. At just the right time, God gave us just what we needed. And he offers it still today to a world that desperately still needs it. And the good news is he's available. And unlike a PlayStation 5, you can find it. And it's free. Quantity's unlimited. And it's for all of us. Hey, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Jesus is the reason for the season. Hey, if you're able to stand after this marathon, let's pray. Father, we bow before you, so grateful that you split our time in half. You took us from not knowing you to fully receiving all that you have for us. And Lord, our tiny little finite minds cannot comprehend the fullness of your presence in a world that is so desperate to not know you. And yet, Lord, you offer us this day the celebration of faith, that we can know you, that we can be family, that your Spirit can reside in us. Make it so, Lord. Allow us to receive the adoption of family, that we can truly belong to you and have all that you have for us. Lord, help us in these perilous days, difficult, frustrating, dark days, to know that truly light has dawned. Hope has come. And Jesus, it's all about you. Lord, keep our attention when the world would scream louder. Keep our attention. And may we truly celebrate. May we truly celebrate. the gift of who you are. We ask it, Jesus, in your name. And let all God's kids say together, amen. Amen.